Hi everyone, welcome back to another video for Phantasy Star Online and Blueburst. In today's video, we're going to continue the series of the lore videos for PSO, and we're going to look at the underground cave system on Ragol. So once you spawn into the caves, one of the first things that you'll notice is that it is this weird mix of natural and man-made. So it's clearly a naturally occurring cave. You know, you can see, you know, the walls are all made of rock. We've got lava flows everywhere. So it is obviously a natural occurrence. But there is obviously these man-made elements as well, such as these doors are quite clearly man-made. And that tells you that because Pioneer 1 were the only inhabitants that we know of on Ragol before us, this means that this has to have been made by Pioneer 1. So Pioneer 1 were obviously investigating this cave for some reason, and we're starting construction down here. For some reason which we're not sure on yet. So the next thing you'll notice with caves is the enemies. So the enemies are kind of mutated versions of what you might have seen in Forest. There is some unique enemies, but a lot of these enemies are what the game calls altered beasts, which are enemies that have been mutated through one reason or another into these weird mutant life forms. So again, this is just adding to the sort of the peril of Ragol. So we got a hint of that in Forest, where, you know, we had this overlying impression that the enemies had started to turn violent, and this is kind of building on that. We've now got enemies that are actually mutant life forms. We don't know what's mutated them or anything. We don't know why they're mutated, and we don't know why Pioneer want to hear in the first place. But that's something we'll try and figure out as we go through caves. So as with the other areas, Regen Record does leave messages here as well. Wow, this cave is a treasure trove of discoveries. Creatures that have never been seen by people, completely unknown animals. They look like mutant forms of the native animals. Perhaps the government has kept this a secret. It's possible, but for what purpose? So again, Riko is showing this sort of distrust in the government that she showed in the Forest as well. And she's now wondering, why are Pioneer 1 trying to keep all this secret? You know, are the mutant life forms things that were created by Pioneer, or is it a naturally occurring thing that has mutated them? At this point, we don't know, but we just know that Pioneer 1 have been in this cave for some reason, and there are now mutant life forms here. It's all adding up to this kind of distrust of what was happening with Pioneer. You know, was everything above board? So this next message from Riko, this is an interesting one because it is fundamentally just a game tip to tell you to be careful about mines, but there is a little bit more to it. So she just says, if you hear an alert, be careful. There must be landmines around you. You can detect them if you use a trap vision. So it's just a game tip telling you how to avoid the traps. However, it does raise the question of, why are there traps here in the first place? If Pioneer 1 are the only people who've been here before us, why are there traps to prevent people from trying to get in? It just adds up to this suspicion about what was going on with Pioneer 1. What were they hiding here? So once you get to this room in Cave 1, it becomes quite clear that the development in the caves was actually quite far along. So you can see that there's a lot of man-made structure around here. Now, one reason for this is fairly obvious. So you can see there is these huge lava flows in Cave 1, and this would be really good for geothermal energy. So it could be that Pioneer 1 were investigating this to try and harvest the geothermal energy for using in power or for using for heating. So that's one potential reason they could have been investigating these caves. Now, interestingly, once we get into Cave 2, the theme of the area actually completely changes. So we go from this very volcanically active area to what appears to be a more traditional, what you think of as a cave. So we've got quite a damp area. You can see there's like water dripping from the ceiling. We've got a lot of these water pools as well. So it's quite a big shift from Cave 1. So this is, I don't know if this is meant to indicate that it's quite an expansive cave network potentially, but it is a very interesting thematic shift. So the waterfall room in caves, I always find this to be a very interesting room thematically, because I think this is kind of designed to, first of all, it's designed as a marker so that you know you're going through the right way through caves, because if you come across this room, you know you're going the right way. But I also feel like it's meant to be a little reminder of the beauty of Ragol as well. So you do get these odd set piece rooms now and again in PSO where it will just make you want to stop and just take in the scenery. And this is one of those examples. So even though we're in this horrific planet that seems to have a lot going on, we've got all this mystery surrounding what's happened with Pioneer 1 and what they're actually doing. We've now got areas like this where you can just stop and think, this planet is actually beautiful as well. But there is that, it's sort of this dichotomy of the beautiful side of Ragol mixed with this disturbing, unknown side that we're trying to investigate. And it's quite an interesting sort of comparison between the two. So it takes a little while, but we do actually finally get another lore snippet from Rico. I know that Pioneer 1 had some strange aspects to it. In the data that I procured, the consumption rate was far higher than the population. Perhaps there were a lot of non-registered citizens on board. Why? What was their purpose? So this is really, really interesting because... So Rico has noticed in the records that the consumption of, I assume, food and potentially energy is much higher than it should have been for Pioneer 1. So that indicates that there were a lot more... Well, there was either a lot more people than Pioneer 1 said there were, so non-registered citizens, as Rico was saying, or something else was on board Pioneer 1. Again, at this point, we've got no idea what that actually is, but something was definitely not right with Pioneer 1. We are getting this overwhelming sense of that there was much more than meets the eye going on. So at this point, we don't know if it was... Could it have been that they took extra people with them for no reason, and we don't know the reason why and why they weren't registered? Or was it something else that they were doing instead? This is the next time in the game where you start to feel that something was really, really not right. So in Forest, you may remember that we came across this weird monument that Rico had been told was built to commemorate the arrival of Pioneer 1 on Ragol. But she wasn't convinced about it because she thought that it looked much older. And now we found a second one in the caves. So let's see what Rico's got to say about this one. My first question about Ragol was, why didn't any sentient life exist here? But look at this monument. This is identical to the one I saw in the forest. It's not ours though. Was there an ancient civilization on Ragol? But these monuments are the only evidence I see. It'd be strange if there was a civilization indeed. Can I decipher the characters with my simple tools? So Rico is still trying to translate the characters that are on this monument and the one in Forest. She's now got an idea that it could potentially belong to an ancient civilization. That is the only sort of plausible explanation at this point, because we know that the only known inhabitants of Ragol were Pioneer 1 before us, briefly. That's not to say, however, that there wasn't an ancient civilization long before that, but we just have no records of them. However, she is saying that it is really strange that the only evidence of this civilization is these monuments and nothing else. So at the moment, we're still not entirely sure what these are, and we don't know why they start glowing when you interact with them either. There's certainly a lot more to this than we are privy to at the minute. So finally, we land in Cave 3, and Cave 3 again is another tonal shift. So Cave 1, we had the very natural volcanic cave with elements of the man-made side. Cave 2 was completely different again, but again, you could see there was some man-made activity. When we get to Cave 3, you notice that there is a lot more man-made than anything else. So you can see we are still in a natural cave. You know, you can see that the walls are still made of rock, but there is a lot more of these like support structures. There's a lot more man-made doors. Even the floor here is like almost completely man-made. So there is a lot more development in Cave 3, which makes you wonder, were they trying to hide something down here, like deep in the cave? But once we get to this part of Cave 3, we get a really interesting message from Rico. And again, this gives you an idea of how a man works as a scientist. I've got such mixed emotions. I'm scared, but excited, inspired even. Should I act as a scientist now? Or should I act as a hunter who's facing unknown enemies? I feel like someone's herding me somewhere, but where? To the underground. I feel like I'm being invited. Now, anyone who's played a Phantasy Star before is probably having like major like, oh hell no, moments now, because that's kind of your first hint as to what's going on. It's very, very, very subtle, but very, very subtly hinting at what's happening to Rico. Now, you have to get quite far through Cave 3 before you get this message, but this is your first big indication as to what might be happening on Ragol. So I saw it with my own eyes. An animal metamorphosed when it was pierced by a tentacle from that giant worm. Were the monsters I saw in the cave all changed by that giant worm? So we now know, first of all, that there is a giant worm of some kind, and that it pierced an enemy, and then that enemy changed into a mutant. So it seems like the enemies here must have all potentially been attacked by this giant worm and have all been mutated to these weird freakish abominations that are in caves. So this gives us an idea of what might be happening. However, we don't really know anything at all about this giant worm yet. You can probably see where this is going. And finally, after what seems like an extremely long time, we finally get to the boss portal of caves. So caves is a much, much longer area than forest. And we get to the boss of the area. And you'll be unsurprised to hear that the boss is the giant worm that Rico was just talking about. So this is a boss called Darol Lair. So this guy, you don't really find out anything about him during the main story. You have to do some of the side story to understand what he actually is. But basically, he is an experiment that was being kept. I can't go into too much about who was keeping him or what the purpose was of that now. But all I need to know at this point is that it was a life form that was being held and was being experimented on and studied. And something went horribly, horribly wrong, and it then mutated everything in caves. So that's kind of a rough idea of what Darol Lair is. It's a very, very freaky looking enemy. You can see it looks completely alien to anything we've fought so far. And you can see it's using this attack where it's trying to pierce us. So this is the tentacles that it would use to metamorphose the animals in caves. Now, as we defeat Darol Lair and we come to a stop on this raft, it's worth sort of looking around and seeing what is actually here. So obviously this is some kind of like underwater, whether it's a sewer system or a canal. But you can see it's very, very man-made. You can see this is essentially entirely built by people. So you can only assume this was built by Pioneer 1. Now, what the purpose of this was, we have no idea. All we know is that this giant worm escaped into this canal system and then went on to infect everything in caves. Now, we don't know why that worm was being held and studied. We don't know if it was Pioneer 1 or if it was some relic back from the ancient civilization at this point. We're really not sure. But the fact that this is all seemingly quite modern and quite technologically advanced does seem to indicate that maybe it was something to do with Pioneer 1. And again, it's just building on this sort of unease of Pioneer 1 was obviously doing something that they shouldn't have been. Something went horribly wrong on Ragol. It ended up with a huge explosion. At the moment, we don't really know the specifics. We're still not too far forward in that, but we are starting to build up this mental picture now of what was happening on Pioneer 1 at the time. Now, whether everyone on Pioneer 1 was aware of what was going on, we don't know. This does seem very hidden away from the public eye. If you think that a lot of the public of Pioneer 1 and the residents were going to be based in forest, in like the residential areas, this is very much out of the way of that and out of the public eye. So it does beg the question of, was this something that was being done in secret that Pioneer 1 didn't want the rest of the crew to know about? It's kind of hard to say at this point, but it is looking like it could be going towards that way. We also, when the raft finally stops, we actually stop at this little platform here. Now, the stupid thing about this, I've always found this funny with PSO, is that this platform, it's essentially meant to be like the way you get to the next area. The problem is that there's no door. So perhaps the idea was that you would pick up a raft and use a raft as like a taxi service to get to another area. I don't know, but I've always found it kind of funny that there's no door to actually go anywhere. But you can see this is obviously man-made and is definitely, if it wasn't Pioneer 1's doing it, someone else is doing. But as we know that Pioneer 1 were the only recent residents of Ragol, it kind of pins the blame on them to an extent. So for now though, we'll just go back to Pioneer 2. So again, at the moment, we really have no idea what is actually going on in Ragol. We just know that the only facts we've got so far is that we know there's been a huge explosion. We've lost all contact with Pioneer 1. And we are now getting some evidence together that maybe Pioneer 1 was doing something it shouldn't have been. But whether that was the top brass in Pioneer 1, keeping it hidden from the rest of the public, or whether they were all in on it, we have no idea. But something was going on that maybe they shouldn't have been doing. And Rico is obviously very interested in this and trying to figure out what exactly happened. So I'll end this one there for today. In the next lore video, we'll go to the next area and we'll try and figure out what exactly Pioneer One was doing and why all these events have happened. So hope you've enjoyed it. If you have, please consider liking, subscribing, or joining as a member to the channel. We do typically a couple of uploads a week, and we stream once a week on Sundays. We also have a Discord you can join as well, so feel free to join us there. And you can also follow me over on X @SectionSkyLight as well. Yeah, hope you've enjoyed the video, and hope to see you guys in the next one.